So today we will be discussing about another source of noise in case of digital communication system. So I have discussed this issue a little bit in one of the lectures of this particular unit, and that is the source of this particular noise is known as inter-symbol interference. In short, it is known as ISI. So first of all, let me write it down. The name of the noise. So this is known as inter-symbol interference, or in short, it is known as ISI. First of all, let us try to understand what is the source of this inter-symbol interference, and then we have to find out some means so that this ISI can be eliminated to some extent from any digital communication environment. Now, as you know, for any digital communication system, the symbols are being transmitted in the forms of ones and zeros. So if I have a symbol like this, say 1 0 1 1, like this, let it be the symbol or pulse train or bit stream. So we can represent the symbol 1 by means of a pulse of amplitude class A, for example, as we have discussed in the last class. Let it be like this. Symbol 1 has been represented by sending a pulse of amplitude class A and duration set TB. This is for symbol 1. Let it be GT. And the symbol 0 is being represented by sending a pulse of amplitude, say, minus A, and the duration being the same, that is TB. So that is for symbol 0. So the same signal, I mean GT. Now the thing is that if I just consider this wave pattern, this wave pattern, they are basically limited in time domain. So as you understand, this signal GT is limited from 0 to TB, and this signal is also limited from 0 to TB. Now, since they are limited in time domain, so as per as the property of the Fourier transform is concerned, this particular signal will be frequency unlimited or band unlimited. So you can also verify this property just by performing the Fourier transform on those particular symbols or waveforms. Then you'll see that the corresponding wave shapes are nothing but the sync function, as we have already discussed in the some of the previous lectures. So if I just consider sync function, so which is basically a frequency unlimited kind of thing. So a signal which is time limited results in a signal which is frequency unlimited or band unlimited. Now the problem is that whenever you are making an attempt to send those information through a channel which is essentially band limited, so at the end of the channel, you expect that the output that you are getting will also be band limited. So now let us try to understand the scenario just like this. So we have a band limited channel. We have a band limited channel. That means it can allow only a band of frequency, a finite band of frequency. Now the input to this band limited channel is a time limited signal, just like this pulse 101100 or any pattern you can expect over here. So time limited signal. So as you understand, time limited signal means band unlimited over here. So now you are making an attempt to transfer some signal which is theoretically band unlimited to a band limited channel. So since the channel is band limited, the output of this particular channel will also be band limited. Now band limited means what? It will be time unlimited. So as far as the time domain representation is concerned, at the output of this band limited channel, you can have time unlimited signal. Now here you can see that the signal for 1 is extending from 0 to TB. Signal for 0 is extending from TB to 2TB. Waveform for 1, this one, is from 2TB to 3TB, and so on. That means if I consider any nth symbol, if I just consider any nth symbol, so for the nth symbol, the signal will exist for, signal will exist for, or rather I should write, signal will exist from n minus 1 TB, n minus 1 TB to n TB. This is the generic expression, n minus 1 TB to n TB. So for the first symbol, if I just consider this symbol 1, so it will extend from 0 to TB. The second symbol, the corresponding signal will exist for TB to 2 TB. For the third symbol, it will exist from 2 TB to 3 TB, and so on. So for the nth symbol at the transmitter end, the corresponding signal will exist only from n minus 1 TB to n TB. That means if I just consider two consecutive symbols, the corresponding signals will not interfere in time. So for each symbol, the time is fixed. For nth symbol, the corresponding time duration is n minus 1 TB to n TB. Now, whenever you are making an attempt to transmit those signals through a band limited channel, eventually at the output of this channel, you could have some time unlimited signal. So what do you mean by time unlimited signal? That means the signal corresponding to the nth symbol will not only exist from n minus 1 TB to n TB, rather it will be extended beyond this particular range. That is because of the fact that you are transmitting the signal through a band limited channel, and this band limited channel will make the time limited signal time unlimited one. As you know, the time unlimited signal is band limited signal in the frequency domain. So as a matter of fact, if I just consider previously over here, if I just consider the transmitter end, at the transmitter end, if I just observe over a window from n minus 1 TB to n TB, n minus 1 TB to n TB, within this range, the signal was existing only for the nth symbol, because there was no such interference amongst the adjacent symbols. However, if I just observe the same window at the output side, that means n minus 1 TB to n TB. Now here, since there is an overlapping between the adjacent symbols, so this is because of a number of symbols. The contribution is there because of a number of symbols, not a single symbol. Number of symbols. However, the decision which you take at this particular range, that means from n minus 1 TB to n TB, will be for the nth symbol. So at the receiver end, you require one reconstruction filter. Normally, it is implemented by means of a matched filter. And then the output of the matched filter is sampled after every TB. And then the sample value is compared with respect to threshold value in a decision device. And accordingly, the decision will be made in favor of either symbol 1 or symbol 0. So that was the logic which we have explained in the last day. So during that time, we have assumed that between the range from n minus 1 TB to n TB, the contribution is because of the nth symbol only. So that's why at the output of the decision device, the decision which you have made, either in favor of symbol 1 or in favor of symbol 0, that corresponds to NF symbol only. However, because of this effect of band limited channel, you understand that from the range n minus 1 TB to n TB, the contribution in the time domain is not only for NF symbol. Rather, the contribution is there for the n plus 1th symbol, n plus 2th symbol, n plus 3th symbol, and n minus 1th symbol, n minus 2th symbol, n minus 3th symbol, and so on. So number of symbols, so these symbols are nothing but n minus k. Number of symbols. So these are the symbols, n minus k, for k equal to say 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. So you are making a decision in favor of symbol n, but the basis on which you are taking the decision is obtained from the symbol n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, n plus 1, n plus 2, n plus 3, as well as n. So this will create a kind of decision error at the receiving end, and this is known as inter-symbol interference. So you have to ensure that at the decision interval or at the decision instant, whenever you are taking the decision, that means if I just consider once again the block diagram of the receiver, you know that there is an integrator, that means this match filter can be represented by means of an integrator, and then the integrator output is sampled and then it is compared in a decision device with a threshold lambda, and then there could have been two different decisions, either symbol 1 or symbol 0. And this sampling operation is done at every n TB, that means at TB, 2 TB, 3 TB, 4 TB, and so on. Now, you cannot get rid of a band limited channel, because we know that whenever we are making an arrangement for a wireless communication or mobile communication, the channel we have at our hand is obviously band limited, because there are plenty of services that you need to provide through a same channel. If I just consider wireless communication, so through a same wireless channel, air media, we are sending a lot of signals. We are sending the audio signals, the AM radio we are sending. We are also sending the FM signals. We also transmit the television signals and also the cellular communication through the same media. So audio signal, video signal, image signal, so different types of signals are being sent through a same channel. So obviously, there should have been some demarcation, or there should have been some allocation for each and every application. So this simply suggests that the channel which you're using for your particular operation is obviously a band limited channel. So this inter-symbol interference, or ISI, is inevitable, but you have to devise some means so that this inter-symbol interference can be minimized to some extent. So the matched filter will, or this integrator will compute the area under the curve of the pulse waveform over here, and the resultant value is computed at every n TB. That means at TB, 2 TB, 3 TB, and so on. So you have to devise some condition so that the contribution from the adjacent symbols will be zero at the decision instant. So what is the decision instant? Decision instant is NTB, because there is a sampler circuit, and this sampler circuit will sample the output of this integrator at every NTB. And this value is compared with respect to threshold. So you have to ensure that at time NTB, whenever the sampler is finding out the output of this integrator, then the corresponding value, that means y of ntb, which we have mentioned in the last class, y of ntb, so let this be xt and this be yt, and you are calculating this yt at every t is equal to ntb, and that value is computed over here, and it is compared with respect to threshold value lambda over here. So you have to ensure that whenever this integrator output is computed at t is equal to ntb, it should be free from any type of intersymbol interference. So there could have been some intersymbol interference for other value of t, but at the decision instant, whenever this sampling operation is being performed, at that time, there should not be any interference, any contribution resulting from the adjacent symbols. Now, while achieving this objective, another thing which you must keep in your mind is that the bandwidth requirement of the channel should be as minimum as possible, because this is the one of the basic requirements for any digital or mobile communication system, that bandwidth being the resource of any communication system. So while maintaining the different parameters at the desired levels, so the bandwidth requirement should be as small as possible. So now you have two different challenges. One is the use of the minimum bandwidth for the minimization of this inter-symbol interference. So Nyquist was the first person to solve this problem. And accordingly, this particular theorem is known as the Nyquist minimum bandwidth theorem. So Nyquist has proved that this ISI could have been minimized if the band limited channel can be modeled like this. Let me just show you the channel first. This is the frequency response of the overall system. See, effective H effective F, that means the effective transfer function. It looks something like that. Let me just show both the positive and the negative frequency, then you can understand it in an elegant way. Just like this. So let it be H effective F. So Nyquist has proved that if the overall transfer function, considering that of the channel, receiver, and transmitter, if it looks something like that, this is known as a rectangular function. Let me explain what is H effective F. So this is nothing but the overall response because of the transmitter, the channel, and the receiver. So assuming that each of them can be modeled as an LTI system, so in that case, in the frequency domain, their corresponding frequency response could have been multiplied to get the effective or the overall frequency response. So HTF is because of the transmitter side, HCF is because of the channel, and HRF is because of the receiver side. So since we have modeled them as an LTI system, so that's why effectively in the frequency domain, their effective transfer function can be modeled by HTF into HCF into HRF. Now, how does this H effective look like? It looks like something this. So we have TS as the passband gain, and the passband exists from 0 to FS by 2. And beyond FS by 2, the stopband starts. So this is an ideal brick wall nature, and this is known as the rectangular function. So in short, that can be written like this: H effective F is equal to TS into, we have the rectangular function, F by FS. FS being the total width of the transition passband, minus FS by 2 to plus FS by 2. So Nyquist was the first person to identify that if the overall transfer function can be modeled like this, minus FS by 2 to plus FS by 2, constant passband, and then it is there is a stop band beyond this FS by 2, then the inter-symbol interference can be minimized. Now we need to check whether this condition is true or not, or how is it true, or how is it nullifying the effect of ISI. So to understand the effect, you need to find out the response of this one in the natural time domain. So for this, you need to find out the inverse transform of this particular response. So let it be H effective T, so which is nothing but the inverse Fourier transform, Fourier inverse of H effective F. So that can be written like minus infinity to plus infinity H effective F into e to the power j twice pi ft df. Now this H effective F will exist from minus fs by 2 to plus fs by 2. So that integration can be, I mean the limits can be changed from minus to plus fs by 2. It's needless to mention that fs is nothing but the sampling rate, or rather I can say that fs equal to 1 upon ts, where ts is the symbol duration. We have previously defined this by bit duration tb. So within this range, this is constant, that is ts, and we have e to the power j twice pi ft df. So if I take ts outside and e to the power j twice pi ft, if I integrate it, then we'll find e to the power j twice pi ft divided by, we should have j twice pi t, and the limit will be from minus to plus fs by 2. If I put the value over here, we will find ts by j 2 pi t into e to the power j pi fs into t minus e to the power minus j pi fs into t. So after simplification, what we can write is this ts by pi t can be taken outside, and here I can write e to the power j pi fs t minus e to the power minus j pi fs t divided by 2j. Now e to the power jx minus e to the power minus jx by 2j is nothing but the sine x function. So that can be written like ts upon pi t into sine pi fs into t. So considering that fs equal to 1 upon ts, that can be written like sine pi t by ts divided by pi t by ts. This is also known as a sine function, sine c of t by ts, sine pi x by pi x, sine c t by ts, t by ts. So if we have, if we can model the overall frequency response considering that of transmitter, channel and receiver by means of this one, then the overall impulse response looks something like that. That means sine c of t by ts, or in other words, this is given by sine pi t by ts upon pi t by ts. Now let us have a look, how does this particular function, this h effective t, look like in the natural time domain. As you know, it's nothing but a sync function, so we have to obey the property, or we have to understand the property of sync function. So the property of the sync function is that, perhaps you know this one, sine cx will be equal to 1 First of all, let me write it down. The property of the sine function, sine cx is equal to 1 for x equal to 0. And this is equal to 0 for x equal to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, and so on. That means for all positive and negative integer. Now, here in this particular case, we have x equal to t by ts. So if I make this particular axis as the time axis, and this axis as the h effective t, then I can draw the corresponding h effective t. So at t is equal to 0, we have a maximum over here, just like this. And then we have a variation like this. So it will extend towards minus infinity. I have just drawn two or three lobes over here, but you should have the extension from plus infinity to minus infinity. It will be something like that. So as you observe over here, as t increases, the corresponding amplitude of the side lobes will also diminish, but it will never be zero. So this point corresponds to t by t is equal to plus 1. So that means this point is ts. This point is 2ts. This point is 3ts. This one is 4ts. And here also, this one is minus ts, this point. This point is minus 2ts. This one is minus 3ts. This point is minus 4ts, and so on. And here at t is equal to 0, there is a peak, and that value corresponds to 1. At t is equal to ts, value equal to 0, t equal to 2ts, value equal to 0. And for any t is equal to plus minus nts, the corresponding value of h effective t will be equal to 0. Now, this corresponds to the output because of an input of delta, because this is nothing but the impulse response. So as you understand, what is meant by the impulse response? So we have a system, overall system, h effective f. You have an overall system, h effective f, in the frequency domain. Now, if the input to the system is a delta function, delta t, then the output will be ht. Now, delta t means what? It will extend, or it will exist only for t is equal to 0. And for other values of t, the value of delta t equal to 0. So if I just observe the delta t in the natural domain, so it will be something like this. So this is t, at t is equal to 0, it will be existing only. And for other values of t, it is not at all existing, the value equal to 0. We are sending this one through h effective f. Now, what are we getting over here? So as you understand, I have also discussed this one in the last class while discussing the Eurabulian kind of noise, that if I have an Eurabulian noise with a power spectral density of n0 by 2, then the inverse Fourier transform of that, which gives rise to the autocorrelation function, it will take the shape of a delta function. So last day we have seen that this RWT, U is nothing but delta T minus U. That means the delta function, which is existing only for T is equal to 0. So in the natural domain, it will exist only for T is equal to 0. So it is time limited signal. So in the frequency domain, you'll find that if you just perform the Fourier transform on this delta function, so you'll be getting a constant one. That means the Fourier transform delta t is equal to constant. In other words, I can say that this delta function contains all the frequency components in equal proportion. So ideally, this delta function is a band unlimited signal. Now, you are making an attempt to transmit this band unlimited delta function through a band limited channel. which is identified by this H effective wave. So what do we expect at the output of the band limited channel? You should expect a band limited output waveform, because the channel is band limited. Since the channel is band limited with a bandwidth say F1 to F2, so it will not allow any signal to pass through this system whose frequency is outside this range. So as a matter of fact, the output of this H effective wave is also a band limited signal. Now, what do you mean by band limited signal? If the signal is band limited, it will be time unlimited, just like a sync function. So for delta t, the corresponding output is nothing but the HT, or the impulse response. Now, we have just now calculated the impulse response just by performing the inverse Fourier transform of the H effective wave. And we have seen that this H effective t, the impulse response, or the response because of this impulse input, looks something like that, which is essentially band limited but time unlimited. That means it will extend from minus to plus infinity. However, if I just look at the corresponding intervals at t is equal to nts, t is equal to nts or plus minus nts, or I can write nts, where n is equal to plus minus 1, where n is equal to 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. These are the corresponding sampling intervals. Now you see that at every sampling intervals, so this is for t is equal to 0. So we have transmitted the signal at t is equal to 0. So at this particular point, the contribution resulting from the input is maximum, that is 1. However, if I just consider the contribution of this particular signal, del t, at some other sampling instance, that means ts, 2ts, 3ts, and minus ts, minus 2ts, minus 3ts, you will find that the resultant contribution is equal to 0. Because the value of H effective t is equal to 0 at t is equal to ts, t is equal to 2ts, t is equal to 3ts, and so on. That means this particular signal, delta t, while transmitted through a channel like this, it will not provide any kind of interference to the consecutive symbols at the sampling instant. However, there could have been some non-zero interference between 0 to Ts. So between 0 to Ts, you'll see that this is the interference. This is the interference value. From Ts to 2Ts, this is the value. 2Ts to 3Ts, this is the value. The corresponding amplitude of the side lobes. However, at the sampling instant, so at this particular instant, you take the decision regarding symbol 0. At this particular instant, you take the decision regarding symbol 1. At this particular instant, you take the decision for symbol 2. At this instant, you take the decision for symbol 4. So here, for this delta t function, the corresponding contribution is maximum at t is equal to 0, and it will not create any kind of disturbance to the decision at some other sampling instant. Similarly, if you can transmit another pulse, another impulse function at t is equal to, say, ts, then you could have a shifted impulse function, shifted a sync function at this particular point. Suppose you have transmitted another impulse at t is equal to, say, 2ts, t, so t minus 2, like this. Rather, I should write t minus 2ts. So if it is there at t is equal to 2ts, under this condition, you could have this one maximum at t is equal to 2ts, and the other values are 0, just like this. I'm just drawing a rough sketch, just like this. Once again, the contribution at t is equal to 3ts must be 0. Contribution at t is equal to 4ts must be 0. So there will be 0 crossing at every t is equal to nts, just like this. So this particular symbol, which have been transmitted at t is equal to ts, so it provides the maximum contribution at t is equal to ts and no contribution or zero disturbance at t is equal to ts, t is equal to 0, t is equal to minus ts, and t is equal to 3ts, t is equal to 4ts, and so on. So if the overall system can be modeled by means of this particular filter, then the effect of intersymbol interference can be minimized to some extent. However, this particular observation is having some difficulty on its own. What are the difficulties? First of all, if you just observe minutely the signal delta t and its response h effective t, you'll see that this impulse function, it is existing for t is equal to 0. However, its response is existing from t is equal to minus to plus infinity. That means the h effective wave, which we have designed, in other words, which Nyquist has proposed, this particular shape of the h effective wave, so this is not at all practically realizable, because what you find is that the impulse function is existing for t is equal to 0, but the response due to this impulse function is existing for t less than 0. That means the system which we have designed in the form of h effective wave is not at all a causal system. And since it is not a causal system, so we cannot practically realize this particular system. So this is the first disadvantage or first limitation of this particular observation of Nyquist. And as far as the frequency response is concerned, if I just come back over here, since from the pass band to the stop band, there has been a sharp fall from the pass band to the stop band, and essentially there is no transition band in between the pass band to stop band. So this brick wall nature cannot be realized using a finite number of elements. And moreover, it is also not practically realizable because of its non-causal property. So this is one of the limitations of this H effective wave. And the second limitation is that, although we have mentioned that the symbols will be sampled, output of the mass filter will be sampled at FTT is equal to plus minus NTS. But there could have been some scenario where the receiver is making some error in picking the proper time instant for the sampling. That means instead of sampling at t is equal to nts, somebody can sample at t is equal to nts plus minus some tau, where tau is the sampling time error. Suppose you need to sample at after every 1 millisecond. So 0 second, then 1 millisecond, 2 millisecond, 3 millisecond, 4 millisecond, and so on. Because of some error, it might happen that instead of sampling at 1 millisecond, the sampler is sampling at 1.01 millisecond. So this 0.01 millisecond is the sampling time error. Now, as you find over here, the contribution of the sync function at the timing instant, at the sampling instant, that means t is equal to nts equal to 0. However, the value is non-zero for t not equal to nts. And the value is eventually very large. If I just observe the expression over here, this h effective t, you will find that this is nothing but sine pi t by ts divided by pi t by ts. So we say that the slope of this h effective t is equal to 1 upon t. So the corresponding value, rather in the time domain, if I just observe, the magnitude of these side lobes, it is reducing, but reducing at a rate of 1 upon t. So if there is any error in sampling time, then it will create a significant intersymbol interference. So these are the two limitations which one can find from the Nyquist minimum bandwidth theorem. The first limitation is that because of its ideal brick wall nature, it is not at all possible to realize the system in practice, because ultimately the output what you have observed from this is a non-causal output, although the input is a causal one. So it is not practically realizable, this ideal brick wall nature of the filter. And the second thing is that if there is any timing error, timing jitter, if it exists at all in the receiver side, then it will create a significant ISI. In case the receiver samples at every t is equal to nts, then there is no problem. The resultant contribution is equal to zero. But if there is any timing error, timing jitter, by some amount, let it be say 1% or say 0.5%, then you find that there has been significant ISI because of the slope of this particular function. You find that this H effective t reduces at a rate of 1 by t. The slope reduces at a rate of 1 by t. Beyond this, t is equal to 0, beyond this peak value. So the slope is 1 upon t. So we need to devise some other mechanism so that this particular limitation can be overcome. So accordingly, one popular filter has been proposed in the literature, and this is known as rest cosine filter. And in case of rest cosine filter, what has been done? This ideal Brickwell nature of the overall transfer function has been eliminated, and a roll off is maintained between the pass bond and the stop band. So let me first draw the wave shape of this filter. Let me first draw the wave shape, and then I'll show the corresponding mathematical representation. So instead of ideal Brickwell nature, so the variation from the passband to stop band is relaxed. Let it be H effective F, and now it is known as a rest cosine filter. So that's why instead of writing simple H effective F, let me write it down just like HRCF. HRCF. So it is like this. So this is constant up to this point. This point is constant, so symmetrically placed. Symmetrically placed. So let it be 1 minus alpha by 2ts, where alpha is a roll-off factor. So I'll explain what is meant by alpha. So this point is say minus of 1 minus alpha by 2ts. And then we have the transition band existing from 1 minus alpha by 2ts to 1 plus alpha by 2ts. So it will be something like this. So this point is 1 plus alpha by 2ts. And this one is minus of 1 plus alpha by 2ts. And beyond this point, we have stop band. Essentially, we have three bands over here. This is the pass band ranging from minus of 1 minus alpha by 2ts to 1 minus alpha by 2ts. Then we have the transition band from 1 minus alpha by 2ts to 1 plus alpha by 2ts. And beyond this point, we have the stop band. So mathematically, this can be written like this. This rest cosine filter HRCF, like 1. So as long as mod f value is less than 1 minus alpha by 2ts, so this is a passband region, it's constant. And then we have a cosine shape from this point to that point, the transition band, which is represented by half into 1 plus cos pi mod f into 2ts minus 1 plus alpha upon 2 alpha. Now this is true for 1 minus alpha by 2ts to 1 plus alpha by 2ts. So this is the transition band, and beyond this range the HRCF value equal to 0. So when mod f is greater than 1 plus alpha by 2ts, then you find that the corresponding HRCF equal to 0. So here the variation from the transition from the pass band to the stop band is not at all sharp. Rather, so this is the pass band, this is the transition band, and we have a stop band over here. So the variation from the pass band to the stop band is not at all equal over here, and we are providing a transition band having a shape like this, 1 plus cos of this one, between the pass band and stop band. And this makes it possible to realize the filter in a practical sense. Now, if I just calculate the corresponding inverse Fourier transform of that, you will find that this HRCT, which is nothing but the inverse Fourier transform of this HRCF, if you do the mathematics, you will find that it looks something like that. We have sine pi t by ts upon pi t by ts, just like the previous form, multiplied with cos of pi alpha t by ts upon 1 minus 4 alpha t by 2ts whole square. So as you find over here, if alpha equal to 0, then HRCF is equal to H effective F. We'll be having the same transfer function. The transition band extends from 1 minus alpha by 2ts to 1 plus alpha by 2ts. So in case alpha equal to 0, then these two points will coincide, and HRCF will be once again modified to H effective F. So that can also be observed from the expression of the impulse response. So here, if I put alpha equal to 0, then this cos pi alpha t by ts will become 1. And in the denominator, this will also be 1 for alpha equal to 0. So we have this function sine pi t by ts by pi t by ts. So the previously observed sine function. But in case the value of alpha is not 0, rather greater than 0, so in that case, we have a fluctuation from pass band to stop band like this. And you can also understand what could have been the maximum value of alpha over here. The maximum value of alpha over here will be 1. So I can write the range of alpha will be from 0 to 1. So the alpha, the Roloff factor, will be in between 0 to 1. So under this condition, if I just once again draw the corresponding HRCT, then let us take a look how does it look like, the HRCT for different values of alpha. So I may start with the case for alpha is equal to 0. That means the thing that we have drawn already for the Nyquist filter. This is the sine function. So this is for alpha is equal to 0. Now, if you make like alpha is equal to say 0.5, alpha is equal to 0.5, it will be something like that. I'm just drawing with respect to the dotted line. By means of dotted line, I would like to represent this one. Alpha is equal to 0.5. So it will look something like that. So as you increase the value of alpha from 0 to 0.5, the resultant value of H RCT is also getting reduced. 40 not equal to LTS. So this is for alpha is equal to 0.5. The peak value will be at 1. There is no doubt about that. So this is H RCT. But if I select alpha equal to 0, we will be having the previously obtained sync function. So once again, at every t is equal to NTS, the resultant contribution will be equal to 0 for the other pulses. So these are the sampling instant. So at every t is equal to NTS, at sampling instant, which have been marked by this arrow, you find that the contribution resulting from this pulse will be there only at t is equal to 0. But the contribution resulting from this pulse for other values of t, for t is equal to NTS, will be 0. That means the corresponding value of HRCT will be 0 for t is equal to NTS. However, if you just compare the value of HRCT for different values of alpha, you will see that for green one, which have been marked by alpha is equal to 0.5, the amplitude of the side lobe is significantly less as what has been obtained with alpha is equal to 0. That means if I just consider this HRCT for a non-zero alpha, once again, if I just write it down, the expression for HRCT, it was like sine pi t by ts upon pi t by ts. And then we have this cos pi alpha t by ts divided by 1 minus 4 alpha t by 2 ts whole square. So here you see that for a higher value of 40 much greater than ts, under this condition, this HRCT drops, decays at a rate of 1 upon t cube with respect to 1 upon t, what has been observed with H effective t. For H effective t, if I just write it down, the expression for H effective t, this is nothing but the first factor of this HRCT. So it was like sine pi t by ts divided by pi t by ts. So as you understand, this numerator is always bounded because it's a sine function. So sine pi t by t is always bounded. And the denominator, we have pi t by ts. So pi is a constant. Ts is also constant for a particular sampling procedure. So here, H effective t is proportional to 1 upon t. So as t increases, H effective t will be reducing. And it reduces, it decays at a rate of 1 upon t. On the other hand, if I just compare this one with HRCT, here you find that both the sine and cos, these are bounded function. So their limit is 1. Then you have 1 upon pi t by ts over here and 1 minus this one, 4 alpha t by 2 ts whole square over here. So for t much greater than ts, then this one can be neglected with respect to this one, 4 alpha t by 2 ts whole square. So under this condition, this HRCT will decay at a rate of 1 upon t cube, t square here and t over here. So 1 upon t cube. So the decaying is much more faster as compared to this H effective t. So this H effective t is for the Nyquist one. And this HRCT is one, this one for a raised cosine impulse response. So the raised cosine impulse response decays at a much higher rate as compared to that of Nyquist filter. Then what is the advantage of having a faster decay, the advantage is that even if there is some timing error at the receiver end, sampling time error at the receiver end, then also, since this dotted one is having lower magnitude as compared to the bold one, this blue one, so even if there is some jitter, even if there is some timing error in sampling, then also the corresponding contribution, this interference resulting from the previous or the next pulse, will be significantly small. And moreover, since it decays very faster rate, at a very high rate with respect to t, then obviously after a few samples we can just neglect those side lobes, because here you find this is the main lobe extending from minus ts to plus ts, and beyond that we have a number of side lobes, and it will extend up to plus infinity in this direction and up to minus infinity in that direction. So as long as these amplitudes are large, these side lobe magnitudes are large, peaks are large, so you have to use a more number of samples in order to closely approximate this HRCT or HFT. However, if the corresponding sample value, magnitude, if this is small enough, as we have obtained with the HRCT, we can say that HRCT decays at a faster rate, and after a few samples, say after 5 or 10 samples, we can safely neglect the effect of an HRCT. So in other words, I can say that even if this HRCT is a time unlimited signal, because it is obtained at the output of a band limited channel, so even if it is time unlimited, ideally it will extend from minus to plus infinity, but because of its property of a very fast decaying beyond this main lobe, beyond this t is equal to plus minus ts, since it decays at a very high rate, so we can consider only few side lobes apart from the main lobe. So although it is time unlimited, but we can always closely approximate it to be a time limited signal with a defined number of samples. You may also argue that, okay, this signal, this HRCT, is also a non-causal signal because it extends for some minus to plus infinity, and even if I neglect these distant side lobes, then also it is not at all causal, but we can make it causal just by delaying or shifting this HRCT by a fixed number of samples. For example, if I assume that here I can take, say, minus m samples over here and plus m samples over here, so altogether let there be say 2m plus 1 number of samples over here, so I can always make this signal, this HRCT, as a causal signal by representing this one, h causal t. So I can always make this signal as a causal one just by delaying this HRCT by m number of samples. So if I use this particular notation, that this is the expression for HRCT, this is the waveform. Obviously, this particular waveform is not at all causal. So for t is equal to 0 and t greater than 0, it is having some contribution. And moreover, for t less than 0, this HRCT is non-zero. So this is not at all causal. So I would like to make it causal. So how to make it causal? Let us shift the signal in the positive direction by, say, m samples. So the corresponding time duration is mts. So if I shift this one, this HRCT, by an amount of equal to mts, then we can get what is known as the causal impulse response. So in that case, the causality condition is also satisfied. So we have encountered two problems associated with Nyquist minimum bandwidth theorem. The first problem was that we cannot realize the filter in practice because there is a sharp cutoff from the passband to the stopband, ideal Bequal nature, which cannot be realized in practice. So that particular condition has been taken care of by considering a transition band in between the pass band and stop band. And because of the presence of the transition band, the corresponding filter is practically realizable. And secondly, what we have observed is that the timing error, which might arise in the receiver end, so this timing error could result in a higher value of timing jitter in case of the Nyquist filter. As you have observed that for Nyquist filter, the corresponding impulse response decays at a rate of 1 upon t. So in case the corresponding timing error is like 1% or 0.5%, so in that case, the corresponding contribution resulting from the preceding and successive pulses will be significant enough. We cannot neglect this one, and this will cause serious ISI, and ultimately it will affect the VR performance of the overall system. However, if I just consider a raised cosine filter, in case of raised cosine filter, RC filter, so I think it will be better to write down the name over here. So the name is raised cosine filter. So for raised cosine filter or RC filter, what we observed is it is practically realizable because we're allowing a transition band in between the pass band and stop band. And secondly, the decay of this HRCT is at a rate of 1 upon t cube, which is fast as compared to the Nyquist filter. So once again, if I just take a look at the corresponding transfer function of a raised cosine filter, it will look something like that. So in case alpha is equal to 0, we will be having the previously obtained Nyquist filter. So I think it will be better to draw the frequency response once again. In fact, this Nyquist filter is a special case of raised cosine filter, perhaps it has been understood by you properly. So I'm drawing with respect to both the positive and negative frequency. So this is the scenario for Nyquist filter. This is zero. HRCF. So that point was 1 minus alpha by 2TS. Now Nyquist filter is drawn for alpha is equal to 0. Now under this case, when alpha is equal to 0, I can make this point as 1 by 2TS. Now 1 by TS is nothing but the FS. That means the sampling rate. So I can make this point like FS by 2 over here and minus FS by 2 over here. This corresponds to alpha is equal to 0. Next comes the scenario when alpha is equal to say 0.5. So alpha is equal to 0.5. There will be a transition band in between the pass band and stop band. So this point will be at 1 plus alpha by 2TS. So 1 plus alpha, so if alpha is equal to say 0.5, so then 1.5 by 2, 1.5 by 2TS. So I can write this point as 1 plus alpha by 2TS. So for alpha is equal to 0.5, so this is nothing but 1.5 by 2. That means 0.75. fs. Or I can write 3 by 4 fs. So let this be drawn with respect to black. Just like this. So this point is at 3fs by 4. This point is at minus 3fs by 4. And this is for alpha is equal to 0.5. And I may select the last value of alpha. Let alpha be 1, because the range of alpha is from 0 to 1. The role of factor from 0 to 1. So if I select alpha to be 1, this value will become 1 plus 1 by 2ts, that is 2 by 2ts, that is fs only. So if this is extended further, then at alpha is equal to 1, it will be something like that. Let me draw with respect to, say, using green. Let this be the shape. All that is not properly drawn. Using any software, you can clearly draw this one. Anyway, let me try. We have a cosinusoidal shape over here. So it will be something like that. I think it will be better to draw from this end. Just like this. And this one is for alpha is equal to 1. And this point is fs. This point is minus fs. So here, if I just consider the bandwidth requirement, so bandwidth requirement of the filter HRCF, the bandwidth requirement is given by 1 plus alpha by 2ts, because this is the end of the transition band, and beyond this point the stop band starts. So bandwidth requirement is given by 1 plus alpha by 2ts. And accordingly, if this is written by, say, B, so we find that the symbol rate which is equal to 1 upon ts, you can also write the symbol rate to be like rs, number of symbols in 1 second, is given by 2b by 1 plus alpha. Now this is a scenario for baseband system. So in case of baseband system, this frequency will be at 0. So therefore the corresponding bandwidth requirement is nothing but 1 plus alpha by 2ts. So for baseband system, the minimum frequency will be at zero. So the if I just once again go back to this particular slide, here you see that the minimum frequency is zero. Pass band is extending from zero to 1 minus alpha by 2 ts, and 1 minus alpha by 2 ts to 1 plus alpha by 2 ts, we have a transition band, and beyond this 1 plus alpha by 2 ts, we have a stop band. So the bandwidth is extending from 0 to 1 plus alpha by 2 ts. So for a baseband system, the bandwidth is given by 1 plus alpha by 2 ts. But in case, whenever this particular pulse shaping filter, so these filters are known as pulse shaping filter, so that we can modulate the corresponding pulses. So this is not the RF modulation. Rather, I can also use the term like so that we can shape the pulses in such a way that it can pass through the band limited channel in such a way that the inter-symbol interference or the effect of inter-symbol interference can be minimized to some extent. So the bandwidth of this pulse shaping filter, whenever they are operated in the baseband, is given by 1 plus alpha by 2 ts. Now, in case this pulse shaping operation is carried out in the RF frequency or radio frequency, in which case this entire signal or this entire band is riding on a carrier frequency FC. So under this case, so this middle frequency will be at FC, this one, and we have FC plus 1 plus alpha by 2 ts and FC minus 1 plus alpha by 2 ts in either side of the carrier frequency. So under this condition, the bandwidth requirement of the RF channel is given by 1 plus alpha by 2 ts multiplied with 2. So in which case you will find that the bandwidth requirement for RF channel, so let me write it down for RF channel, what is happening. So this is the scenario for baseband. And for RF channel, whenever this pulse shaping filter is riding on a carrier frequency, so under this condition, the bandwidth requirement is given by 1 plus alpha by ts instead of 1 plus alpha by 2 ts. So this will be the bandwidth. And accordingly, the symbol rate RS for RF channel is given by B by 1 plus alpha. So what we can deduce from this expression is that the bandwidth requirement Let me go to the next slide. The bandwidth requirement for this type of system So bandwidth requirement, that is B, is given by RS into 1 plus alpha by 2. For baseband, and for RF or for broadband, I can write like RS into 1 plus alpha. So bandwidth requirement is given by RS into 1 plus alpha by 2. So for a fixed RS, so whenever this sampling rate is fixed, that means TS is fixed, so 1 upon TS is also fixed. So in which case you will find that as you increase the alpha, the corresponding bandwidth requirement will also be enhanced for fixed RS. So I am assuming that the symbol rate is fixed, that means RS is fixed. For fixed RS, as you increase the value of alpha, consequently, it will also increase the value of the bandwidth requirement. And for alpha is equal to zero, as you observe over here, if you put alpha equal to zero, the bandwidth requirement is given by RS by 2 or 1 upon 2 ts. So which is the minimum bandwidth as prescribed by Nyquist. But you have seen that with alpha is equal to zero, there has been some significant limitations which you need to encounter. So alpha is equal to zero is not a very good option for us. But at the one hand, we are getting that increasing value of alpha, the corresponding bandwidth is also increasing. But as you increase the alpha, if I just once again write down the expression for this HRCT. So first term, so I think it will be better to write the first term as H effective T or H Nyquist T. Say H Nyquist T, the same expression. And apart from that, we have the part that is cos pi alpha T by Ts upon 1 minus 4 alpha T by 2 Ts whole square. So as you increase the value of alpha, you have also seen that the corresponding decaying will also be more, because if everything is fixed, that means if Ts is fixed and if this H Nyquist is fixed, under this condition, this H RCT will decay with respect to 1 upon alpha square. So it will decay with respect to 1 upon alpha square. So if you increase a higher value of alpha, so under this case, you will find that the corresponding decay is also large. So this has also been validated just by considering this H RCT for different values of alpha. So here you have seen that for alpha is equal to 0, we have got this blue line, the solid one. For alpha is equal to 0.5, we have got this dotted line. And if you increase the value of alpha to 1, then you'll see that the corresponding contribution in the main lobe as well as in the side lobe will be even less. So increasing alpha, higher bandwidth is the disadvantage for us, but we are getting the additional advantage that if you increase alpha, then we have less jitter. That means the contribution resulting from the, in other words, I can say that contribution from adjacent signals will be less. So this is the meaning of the term jitter, contribution resulting from the adjacent signal will be less. That means it will give rise to less ISI. If there is any sampling time error. So to have minimum ISI, minimum intersignal interference, we have to use the maximum value of alpha, which in this case is equal to 1. And under this condition, the bandwidth requirement will be twice the bandwidth, or rather twice the minimum bandwidth as prescribed by Nyquist. So we have to make a proper trade-off between this power efficiency and bandwidth efficiency. Increasing the value of alpha, we can design a power efficient system in the sense that there will be less ISI and there will be less bit error rate at the receiver side. But on the other hand, if I increase a very high value of alpha, it will be having a significant effect on higher bandwidth, because as you obtain over here, the bandwidth is given by RS into 1 plus alpha by 2. So increasing alpha, it will also consume more bandwidth. So the system will become bandwidth inefficient. So higher alpha means, lastly, let me summarize the effect of alpha. So higher alpha means, higher alpha signifies power efficient, but bandwidth inefficient system. Because you require more bandwidth, because bandwidth is directly proportional to alpha. And lower alpha means power inefficient, that means there is a provision of high jitter and high BER, but you require minimum bandwidth as prescribed by Nyquist. And bandwidth efficient. And the minimum value of alpha was 0. And for this, we can have a filter like this. Alpha is equal to 0 corresponds to this kind of filter. Fs by 2 minus fs by 2. This is f Nyquist filter, h Nyquist f or h effective f. So this corresponds to alpha is equal to 0. The system is power inefficient, but bandwidth efficient because it requires the minimum bandwidth to achieve 0 ISI. So with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on this inter-symbol interference.